So my name is David Abink. I'm a professor in human-robot interaction with a focus on haptics. That means physical manipulation and touch and feeling and those kind of things. And that means that for a long period in my career, I worked on this problem. How does a single human somehow interact with a single robot? And that field is called human-robot interaction. And then I go to conferences and I write papers and I meet my colleagues in that. And then actually the question we ask now is something larger, right? So how do we together as human society somehow steer robotics and also artificial intelligence in a way that we can control it? And so then when I see artificial intelligence, then actually it's a different field already. And then if this thing that I'm holding is not a robot, but it's an algorithm, then all my haptics solutions with physical interaction doesn't work, right? And then it's a different field and different conferences. And then when you actually try to, you know, show the real complexity outside of the little isolation where I usually do my work, then we have actually communities of people using robots and some of them not using robots. And maybe there's linked pieces of algorithms and software, and some of them are embodied as robots. And then if we zoom out further, then it's society, and society exerts all kinds of influence and perhaps even control. And the other way around, and then I get very nervous, and then I really don't know how to answer these questions. So I'm very happy that I have my colleagues from AI Tech and all of you here to help understand how to think scientifically about this issue of control, right? And so control, from my perspective, I have a background in control engineering, and I'm familiar with these kind of schemes, and we can very clearly, you know, talk about controllability and observability, and we can calculate everything. But in essence, control is also about, you know, how do we realize desirable or undesirable situations. And so we know that if this feedback property is of the closed loop, if it's you know, not well tuned, then we might get you know, explosions or things that die out. And but we can also get equilibrium or homeostasis, and that in some cases is what we would like to have. And so nature is actually full of these. If you look at control in humans, you know, it's extremely complicated. It happens at different scales. So at the cellular level, you can already see this kind of self-organizing principles. And at neuromuscular level, we have all these control loops, self-correcting, making sure you keep your balance. And a lot of my background is in that, trying to quantify that and understand that. And then human as a controller in these kind of loops, using visual and vestibular input, that's also the kind of models and measurements I often do. And then humans interacting with other agents, humans or robots, or perhaps this whole complex social technical system. Yes, that's what I feel then as well. Yeah, just yeah. So and if that's not complex enough, you know, are you throwing my laptop around? You know, no control. And so you don't need to understand this, but this is just a recent attempt of me and my colleagues to show this all these hierarchical parts of control we can have. Let's say operational control, how we actually move our muscles. We can then have, maybe if you think of car following, you know, how do I control my steering wheel and my gas pedal? And then one level higher, we talk about tactical control. What kind of, you know, set point do I have? How far is my distance to this lead vehicle? If I'm very close, I have to do a lot of control actions. If I'm very far, I don't have to do that. So that impacts actually the low-level control. And if you go one level higher, we don't talk about tactical tasks anymore, but strategic tasks. You can select routes where there's not so much traffic, so you can relax a bit. So all of this control for humans is already interacted, and then we can have all sorts of robotic or artificial intelligence support systems, where at each level we can have interaction, control, communication, set points, adaptations. So, well, there you go. So it's complex. That was the main first part that I'd like you to remember. The second part I'd like you to remember is that from my perspective, we always talk about autonomous systems and as if autonomy is somehow the end goal. And a colleague of mine, Frank Flemish, actually says, well, you know, with kids, you know, autonomy is important, but then it's also important that they act socially and cooperatively at some point. And perhaps it's the same with the systems that we design. Autonomy is not the end point. We're somehow interested in systems that can cooperate and coexist in our complex world. And as a kind of stimulating example, you might think that horses and zebras, and that's pretty much the same thing. Zebra is just a horse with some different coloring. But that's actually not true. And so this very wealthy guy tried to make an impression in London by trying to show, horses, that's just for the poor people, you know. Like real guys, they have zebras. So, but it didn't really work. And because apparently zebras, they are not very much susceptible to being domesticated. Yeah, so they're autonomous, all right. And there are a lot of the individual components are probably very similar. But there's something in the way that they interact with humans, or perhaps with other zebras, that doesn't really allow them to be domesticated and cooperated with so well. And so that's very different than this metaphor of, you know, a rider on a horse, where, you know, you, through forces on the reins, can interact, and the horse can tell you, oh, yeah, I don't think that's a good idea, and you can say, well, I do think it's a good idea, and so you can dynamically negotiate and are aware of each other's, perhaps, different goals. And so this kind of metaphor is something that I've applied in a lot of my work together with my colleague Erwin, who will speak after. And so what we do, if we try to engineer this kind of human closely interacting with an intelligent autonomous system, we do often prototype development in driving simulators. And so, for example, we look at different types of drivers. And then we look at different ways to interact. And what we call this horse metaphor, if we translate that in an engineering world, we call it shared control. And so, and then you see here on the y-axis, it's kind of the safety time margin, so higher is better. And then what you see is that for every group of people that we looked at, there's an improvement if you have this shared control strategy. Interestingly, if you let your hands off the steering wheel, in this case, this performance of the car is this. So we actually have very low forces on the steering wheel that kind of nudge you a little bit in the right direction, and at the neuromuscular level you amplify these forces. And it means it's just like walking, a lot of information comes through to my body. Yeah, I don't need to actively pay attention where I'm putting my feet, it just happens. Yeah, not just happens, there's lots of closed loop control algorithms happening here, but I don't have to cognitively think about them. So the interesting thing here is that, you know, you can think about humans are better than automation. And in this case, this may be true. But if we'd increase the gains of this of these forces, we could make it much better. But the interesting part is that this kind of, you know, not 100% perfect human and a not 100% perfect system together behave better than either one of them apart. So that's what Aristotle called the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. And so that says something about thinking about a joint system. That's what we try to engineer in my lab. So conventional, this is not done. Maybe not many of you have heard of shared control, but you've heard of different solutions, which look something like this.
Okay, so we're gonna accelerate a little bit here. Okay, we're at 60. No, you stay on the freeway. Bad car.
Right. So this Tesla suddenly loses track of its lane and decides to, you know, take a right turn, even though that's not really possible. And then luckily there's the meaningful human control of the driver, who is always paying attention and always has his or her hands on the steering wheel, to act as a backup system. Great technology, really silly interaction. So this is human as a backup system. Yeah. And this human doesn't look very happy. It's an inhuman task. We shouldn't be doing this. We're not good at that. Yeah. And so even then, you can give legal responsibility to the human to say, you should do this. It's in the manual. Sometimes it goes wrong. And we start to do other things. So this is called traded control. Yeah, and that means either the human or the automation is the boss, and never the twain shall meet. Yeah, which is that's not the only way to think about the design space. So if you look at more extreme scenarios, so this was on a highway, but if you have a system failure right before the onset of a curve, you can imagine which one is the traded control solution, where you have your hands on the steering wheel, perhaps your mind somewhere else, and which one is the shared control solution, where you continuously steer and all of a sudden you think, hey, that's strange, there's no forces, okay, I steer. It's like misstepping and then you quickly, reflexively correct, and then you're aware, hey, wait, something happened, but you already did the right thing. Yeah, and so that's in emergency situations. And you could think, you know, this human-robot interaction design really matters in engineering the trade-offs that my colleague Professor Fisher was talking about. So if you look at the joint system performance, and here on one axis, you know, manual control, no support, and on this interaction, a system that works great, well, you know, sometimes in certain situations. And if not, the human is a backup system. We call this traded control. Then you can design all sorts of systems in between that that only protect you a little bit when you're outside of certain bandwidth, or that continuously guide you, which is something that we develop a lot, or continuously guide you but with a strong stiffness. And so on this axis it will be much more authority. And then the interesting thing is, you know, if everything happens safely within the design boundaries of autonomous systems, you know, then the more feedback you give and the stronger the authority of the system, the better the performance. You can do other things, you can have time to do other things, that's great. But the interesting part, of course, is that, well, sometimes we reach the boundaries, sometimes unexpectedly, sometimes very suddenly, and what happens then? You know, and that needs to be taken into account in the evaluation and in design of these systems. And so we've established these kind of protocols. If you want to read more, this is the paper, where we actually show that this is kind of the sweet spot for this particular scenario, where you get most of the benefit already, but none of the downsides. Yeah, so these kind of experiments can help make, you know, informed decisions. One step further, thinking about the joint system, one of the hypotheses we had is as soon as you have support, and you might think that people might misuse this support. If I'm helped, it means often I think, oh, I have more time, so I could go speeding. And so this is a track with lots of curves and a bit of straight part, and that's what happens if you don't support people. These are dangerous speeds. And so if we give shared control, then what happens? Indeed, people start to speed. And this is dangerous. You shouldn't be doing that. So you could give all sorts of warning, you could protect. But what you could also do is say, well, I will just remove a little bit of the support as soon as you exceed speed limits. So that means I take away part of the interaction. You'll have all the benefits here, but none of it here. And that means you, without instructions, without anything, you actually change your behavior to avoid this, because it's nice to have all this support and to stay here. So these are ways of thinking about including human adaptation and behavioral adaptation into the design bottom-up. So I guess that kind of resonates with Kevin Kelly's idea of out of control. If you don't know the book, it's interesting to read. And he says that, you know, maybe we should need to engineer the bottom-up symbiotic behavior really well, so that perhaps we can avoid a lot of the top-down control and rules and legislation. So that's my take-home message. Cooperation, not autonomy. A lot of traded control issues we can avoid with different design paradigms like share control, and this is important. So there we go. Now the floor is to Erwin. After that, Nick and Arkady will give their talks. Erwin.
Thank you.